spectacular festival pageant of high time magic and imagination, in thousands of sparkling lights and electro-symphonic musical sounds, the Disneyland Electrical Parade. Thank you.
Welcome to the WDW Travel Show, the only show dedicated to the Disney travel experience. Parks, resorts, cruises, food, domestic and international. Join our chat room at the website and interact. And if you have an idea for a future show, be sure and submit it. Time to get your ears on and let's join the WDW Travel Show.
And welcome, everybody. This is the first episode, number 101 of the WD Travel Show, and we are glad to have you with us. We're going to tell you a little bit tonight about what we are trying to do and give you some ideas of things we're going to do in the future and maybe that you can get involved with as well. Right now, I have a little bit of echo in my head, so I'm going to try to figure out how to stop that. But let's get everybody on board now. Come on in, if you would, guys. We're going to have a revolving group of people who will come in. And is it echoing on everybody, or is it just me here?
Sounds just like you, Ed.
Okay, so.
I don't hear anything.
Yeah, I don't hear echoing either. Okay.
All right, so we'll get that worked out. Let's talk about exactly what we're going to be doing here on the show. What we're going to be doing in the future is we're going to be talking about Disney from the travel side of things. Not so much from the parks. We'll talk about parks. We'll talk about a lot of different things. But most people involved in the show are travel-related people, travel professionals, and all that. So let's meet gang number one, as it will grow as we go along. Aljon, tell us about you.
Hello, I'm Aljon Goh, and I help with Sorcereo as their station manager. You can find us at srsounds.com. And I also have my own Disney, Marvel, and Star Wars blog called JediMasketeer.com, and I love the parks, I love the films, and hopefully we can share some of what we know and get you involved in the show. So I appreciate you inviting me to be here, Ed. And now, how about Kristen?
I'm Kristen. I'm a travel agent with Magical Journeys that specializes in Disney, Universal, and cruises. I also am the owner of CookingWithMickeyBlog.com, where you can find information on all your favorite places to dine at Disney.
Ed.
Very good. And my name's Eddie Owen. Of course, I'm with, I have a little company called ELO Travel. I also have the Cruise Paper blog and a bunch of other stuff that we're all working on. And you can find all of that at our website. And if you're watching this on our YouTube channel, you might want to go to the website because there's a chat area there where you can get involved. There's a little chat window box there. So as you're watching along, if you have any questions or anything like that, you can get involved. I do want to remind you, we do have a kind of a tentative schedule of some shows that are coming up. There's one minor change on this I will tell you about. On tonight we're talking about, of course, dining programs and free dining. And then August 6th, which is next Monday, we were supposed to talk about the art of animation. We're going to have to move that show to Tuesday. And then after that, it looks like we'll have those shows from Mondays from then on. On August 13th, Food and Wine Festival. August 20th, that's to be determined. We may not have a show that day because a couple of our members here are going to actually be at Disney during that period. And then August 27th, back talking about Not-So-Scary Halloween. And Kristen, August 13th is an important day for Food and Wine because of what happens August 14th, correct?
Yes, the special events such as, you know, the Party for the Senses, events like that, as well as the culinary and wine demonstrations will be available for purchase starting that morning.
Sounds good. All right. Well, I'm still experiencing. I've got two things going in my ear here, so I'm a little bit on delay with you guys, so just bear with me while I figure that out. Now, as we get the show going and go down the road and develop these things, we want to talk about the things that you guys want to talk about as well. And one of the things that came up over the last 3 or 4 weeks, maybe a month, was the free dining program and the dining programs in general. And free dining, I think Barbara is watching. I told her to watch, and Barbara actually rescheduled her entire trip to take advantage of a couple of days of free dining. And a lot of people do that. Kristen, you deal a lot with a lot of people. How big an incentive is free dining and the dining programs for people?
I think it's one of the biggest incentives that Disney offers. A lot of people look for it, especially if you're staying at a value or moderate. It is a really good, if not the best deal that you can get. With value resorts, you get the quick service dining plan for free. If you're doing either a moderate or deluxe villa, you end up getting the basic Disney dining plan for free. And all of those can be upgraded. You can upgrade up to the highest of the deluxe dining plan.
Very good. Okay, I finally have figured out why I was echoing. So now we're on good shape. Aljon, you are a blogger. You blog about a lot of different things, including Disney. But you guys make a lot of trips down there. What's your favorite part about all this?
You know, the fact that dining is included in the vacation make it really, really enticing to go at that particular time. Kristen and I, we love to eat. We like to basically set it and forget it and not have to worry about paying out of pocket for certain things. I mean, so the Disney dining plan does have its benefits. I also believe that it depends on how you like to eat and, you know, what type of experience you want to have. I like to sit down and eat. I like the deluxe dining plan, and it can be a good value depending on, you know, how you like to eat. If you're a run-and-gun kind of person and you like burgers and you bring your food to the park, it may not be such a good value to you, but I think everyone should at least try it for the sake of experimenting and experiencing what the parks and what their restaurants have to offer.
You know, you say it may not be a good value for you, but especially now when we're talking free dining, it's a good value for everyone, and we'll talk about that. And Kristen, even we were talking a little earlier, we're going to talk about some things that where you can even make your free dining go farther than you thought. So, I guess we can kind of get into that if you want. Kristen, and you want to talk maybe first about the actual the plans, or do you want to talk about food in general? How long, maybe, for those of us who don't know, and I'll throw myself in that list, has free dining always been a part of Disney, or is this something they came up with in the last few years to try to motivate people to come on board?
It's been something that they've come up with over the past few years. I mean, the dining plan itself is pretty new. I want to say it was maybe 06 is when they first started with the dining plan. And over time, it's changed. You know, it used to include, it originally started with just the basic dining plan. And at the time, it included appetizer and entree, as well as dessert, non-alcoholic drink, a quick service meal. And then it also included gratuity, which is no longer included. So over time, it's changed from what it was, but they had started really doing the free dining program. It was like September and October to really get people during the slow season to come in and try this program they had just started. And over time, there's less and less of it. So when it does become available, it's one of those things you want to jump on it and get it because you don't know if they're going to do it again.
And one of the things about free dining you want to always make sure of, folks, is that normally, I guess they do this every time they do it, it's for a finite range of days, but if you're overlapping, it'll carry through, I guess, as long as you're going to be there. So if you only catch one day of it and you stay an extra week, you actually get the benefits of free dining. Is that correct?
Yeah, just as long as you book. As long as you book by the last day of the date, it's included.
Does it work on the front end like that? If you come in early, will it back up, or is it just on the back end, or do you know?
It's just whatever the first date, like the first time this is going to start coming up this fall, the first date is September 30th. If you are going to be there, say, 5 days early, you're going to be spending like a $10 or a 10-day trip, you would have to, in order to take advantage of that, book it as two different reservations, even if you're staying at the same resort, because it doesn't start till September 30th. But I can't remember off the top of my head what the exact last date is of that, but let's just say it's October 8th. As long as your vacation starts on October 8th, it will carry through to the rest of your trip.
So what you're basically saying is that if you are, well, I understand because you have to have a reservation starting when it's in play.
Yeah.
If you're there before, it doesn't kick in on that same reservation, correct?
Correct.
Okay, so you have to. Okay, that makes sense. Let's talk about the different levels. Well, first off, let me go back. When you go and you stay, and let's say you're going to a value resort, you're going to go to Pop Century, you're going to get what they call, what is a basic free dining, or what's the level there?
That's going to be the quick service dining plan that you get with the value resorts.
Okay.
That's going to include two quick service meals. So that'll be, you know, your entree, dessert, and drink. So you get two of those, and you get one snack. And the snack, it's going to show on the dining plan. You'll see a little logo that lets you know exactly that is part of the plan. If it is not, but it's something that's low in price, you can always ask, you know, because typically it's things up to $4. That's pretty much the standard for it. But, you know, occasionally some things that cost less than that aren't included. I know over in Morocco, if you try and use a snack credit to get a side item, which might be, you know, $2.99, you can't do that. So if you're unsure, just ask whoever the cast member is. They're more than happy to let you know.
Yeah, that's something to bring up is how, if you're new using the dining plan and the free dining and all, how prevalent do they make the accessibility, or how prevalent is the information, you know, when you go in these restaurants, I mean, that you can use this for this or that for that? They make it pretty easy for you?
I think so. I mean, when it comes down to your meals, like say you're going to a sit-down restaurant, one of the first things they're always going to ask you is if you are on the dining plan. And that way when you sit down, they can explain to you what is included, or they'll ask you, you know, have you used the dining plan before? Are you familiar with it? So if you aren't, you can say no, and they can walk you through it and go, this is what's included with your basic plan, or this is what's included with your deluxe plan. They will also let you know any entrees that might be excluded from it.
Now, you also can kind of I'll call it save your points or save your credits and use them different ways. You don't have to necessarily use, if you've got credits for one day, you don't have to use them that day, correct? You can kind of stockpile them.
You can stockpile them all you want. You can, and that's the thing. A lot of times people will forget to use their stat credits, and well, then it gets to be the end, and you're like, oh my gosh, I have, you know, 10 snack credits. What am I going to do? Well, at that point, go to Downtown Disney, hit up Goofy's Candy Shop, and stock up on different things to take home that you can either have at a later date, or you can go, hey, you know, I was thinking of you when I was on vacation. Here you go. Here's some, you know, Mickey Mouse Rice Krispie Treats.
Yeah, because you forgot to use your credits. That's why you're going to do that.
Yeah, just don't let them go to waste, you know? It's such a, you know, I can't tell you, here's a little anecdote. I have to interject myself for a second. Kristen and I were recently, I think this past February, at Coronado Springs. We ended up getting a dining plan, and of course, this time it was not free. Of course, he paid out of pocket for it, but it's still a great value. So Kristen and I are having breakfast at the resort, and in front of us was a man and his family, and he simply, you know, gets his resort mug and his breakfast. And the cast member, as she was ringing him up, says, you know, it comes with a drink. He goes, oh, I'm good. I'm good with my trusty mug. And I said to myself, won't you go back there, grab yourself a soda or a cappuccino or something and take it with you to the park? An example of waste. He paid for something. He's not getting the full value. And you should go ahead and burn that credit through, get a bottle of water at least, and take it to the park and drink it on the tram ride over to the park, you know?
And by the way, personal note here, the Coronado Springs, I forget what they call it, Pepper Market or whatever it's called.
Yeah, you know, Pepper Market.
Pepper Market, that is one of my favorite restaurants. I love eating there as much as anything. And you said something, Kristen, that I did not realize, and that is you can take these snack credits and go to Downtown Disney and get things like candy. You know, I think most people are probably thinking, you know, they have to use it at the restaurant or the snack bars and all, but that's a great idea to be able to use over there. And what do you take it home or eat it yourself? I didn't realize you could do that.
Yeah. And, you know, with some of the desserts in different locations, because some of them might denote a snack credit, but they might not let you use it as a dessert option. It varies by the different restaurants that you go to. So that's always one thing, you know, if you're unsure, just ask. You know, there's a lot of times you can use things on something you would not even think. In the past, Coral Reef has allowed you to get, as one of the non-alcoholic beverages, a smoothie. It's not true everywhere, but it doesn't hurt to ask. So if you're looking at something, you think, hey, I want this. I wonder if it's included. You might as well ask.
Yeah, and sometimes, and I'm thinking maybe sometimes they'll even put a little sign up or something. I wouldn't, you just never know. Or, you know, somebody around will know about that. Now, it's, for those of you who, this show is designed to kind of be evergreen. And by that, you know, we hope that a year from now you'll be able to look at the show and learn something about what we're talking about, whether it be dining plan or free dining. But we will talk occasionally about specifics and specific time frames. And right now we're talking about fall 2012 free dining, which is still available right now through your Disney travel agent. And that's through the end of, you can book it through the end of September, is that correct?
September 29th.
What was that?
The Main Street train is pulling away from the station.
I have no idea where Aljon is. I'm not sure I want to know. and then one other thing about it, as I understand it, one of the things I wanted to do this show about, and I was excited about, was the fact that I've never used the dining plan. And all the years I've been to Disney, I never really thought it was for me. And I'm beginning to think a little differently about that. And I wanted to learn more about it. But you know, when you go to a value resort, you get one level, but is it true you can pay a little extra and bump up to that next level of the dining plan? Is that correct?
Yeah, if you're at a value, you can pay whatever the difference is between the plans. So you could go up to the next level, which is the basic dining, or you can even go up to the deluxe dining. And so you're just going to pay the difference from the cost of the value to whichever one you move up to. Same with basic. If you're doing the basic and you want to do the deluxe, then you're just going to pay the difference in those two.
For those of you who don't know Kristen, she does the Cooking with Mickey blog, cookingwithmickey.info blog. And so you are very, very attuned to food. You've got some other things coming up that people are going to be really excited about when they see that. But kind of give us your, and Aljon, jump in too if you want, give us some experiences with the different restaurants talking about these, the plan. And by that, I mean the different levels, you know, from the very basic to maybe the top of the line that you've used the dining plan on, and give us an idea of what kinds of things people can do.
Well, for one thing, let's start with the quick service, which is going to be counter service locations. And one of them would be the electric umbrella. And that's going to include, you know, like they've got a hamburger, which would then come with French fries. And most places now are offering an alternative, whether it be, you know, carrot sticks or apple slices instead of having your French fries. Over at Columbia Harbor House, you can get steamed fresh broccoli now.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, and then, of course, on top of that, you have your choice of desserts, which are going to be typically something small, like chocolate mousse, maybe yogurt parfait, cookie, brownie, that kind of thing is going to be included as your dessert.
Now, I'm guessing Dole Whips are not included as part of this.
That is a snack.
So
you can use a snack credit on the Dole Whip. You can even do the Dole Whip float and use a snack credit.
Okay, love that, but you can't. Yeah, but you can't use it on a turkey leg.
No, because the price of a turkey leg is at, what, $8?
That's true.
Oh, I can't remember now. It's about somewhere around $8.
It's nearly $8. It's one of our friends' favorite. And actually, we do have a question from the chat room, if I can bounce in here real quick before we
go. Hold on. I know what you're going to ask.
Okay, go for it.
And I am about to get into that, because
okay,
you're going to ask the question about food and wine, right?
Yes.
Okay, because I did see that Barbara asked that.
Okay.
And when it comes to food and wine, that was the next thing I'm going to mention, as far as, like, the turkey leg reference. As I was telling Ed earlier, the food and wine. This is a great great way to use your snack credits. And you can also use them very wisely at the Food and Wine Festival. For example, one of the desserts that they have is a pumpkin mousse, and it's got ocean spray cran raisins and an orange sauce. Now, that's only $1.50.
We're actually going to show that in a few minutes. I just let me throw in here, because we were talking earlier about it, and Kristen gave us a bunch of pictures that she's taken. And if you're not hungry now, you will be by that time, because we're going to show that pumpkin mousse.
Oh, so good.
Another option is the Linda Bean's Perfect Maine Lobster Roll, which runs almost $8. So you have about $8 and $1.50. Both of them you can use a snack credit on. So, and that's where I recommend, if you want the more expensive item, and at Food and Wine, it is denoted on all of the menus. You'll see like a big tea stand that'll have the menu, and it will have the little logo. It's going to be a purple and white logo that denotes that something is included as a snack credit on the Disney dining plan. And that's the kind of thing, the lobster roll, you want to use your credit for. But when you see on there, okay, well, you also want the pumpkin mousse, pay out of pocket, $1.50 for the mousse, and use it for things that you can find on the menus that are, you know, $4 and more, or in the high $3, $3.50 plus range, is an excellent use of those credits.
Talk about the upper-end restaurants. Where have you used the dining plan? In some place, people might not think, you know, one of the maybe it takes two dinner credits or something like that.
Well, one of the best ones that I think to use a two-table service credit for is Narcosis. They offer a surf and turf, which is $69. They do allow you to use your credits and get that dinner. So when you're getting that, and then you can do a cheese plate for dessert instead of maybe, you know, skipping on something sweet. You could choose to do the cheese plate, and that's $14. And then appetizers can run as much as $18. So when you're using it on something like that, it's really adding up. You know, you're gonna, you could easily hit 110 on one for just for one person.
Yeah, over, it makes for a great date night.
Over there. Now that's if you're gonna do the deluxe plan. The deluxe gives you an appetizer, an entree, a dessert, and a non-alcoholic beverage. So if you're doing the deluxe plan, you're really gonna get a good bang for your buck at Narcosis.
In fact, we're going to go through this real quick because Kristen put this together the other day, and let's just kind of talk about, you know, these basics here, Kristen, on the dining plan. We showed this menu a few minutes ago, you know, guest services dining plan, the quick service dining plan, two quick service meals and one snack, the dining plan known as the basic. Now, that's what, is that the one you would get if you were staying like in a, in a value resort, correct?
The basic would be if you were staying at a moderate, deluxe, or deluxe villa.
Okay. One table service meal, one quick service, one snack, and then the deluxe dining plan, three meals, table or quick service, and you have two snacks with that. And then we go to the next, just for those of you who are thinking about maybe taking a trip, all plans are per person, per night. What do they normally run? $35 in that range or a little higher?
If you're going to do, I'm going to go with next year's pricing since it's going to be the higher than it is now.
2013.
Yeah, and I'm going to give the prices based on an adult. It's going to be $37.58 for quick service. Standard dining, what they're doing this year is it's going to have two different prices. For off-season, it's going to be, value and regular season, $55.59. If you go during peak, it's slightly more at $56.94. Now, the biggest jump from this year to next year is going to be for the deluxe dining plan. That will be $99.97 for value and regular, and then $102.27 for peak. So that's a $10 jump in 1 year for that particular plan. But then again, you can choose three meals. So you could do breakfast, lunch, and dinner all at a sit-down restaurant. Then you get your two snacks with that as well. And with your meals on the deluxe plan, you get appetizer, entree, dessert. So unlike the basic where you just get entree and dessert, you're also getting an appetizer. So that plays a lot into why there's such a significant price difference between the basic and the deluxe.
And, you know, those prices sound very, very high to someone who maybe hasn't, you know, been to Disney. But if you go and get an inexpensive dinner, you're looking at $15 to $20, you know, just about anywhere. Now, you need a snack bar, but even a snack bar, $7 or $8, $9.
Easy.
Yes. So, you know, don't let the, if you're watching this and thinking that's way high, well, you don't have to go that route for one. And then the other thing is there's a possibility there that you still can save some money. Also on these rules you were talking about, Kristen, each person must be on the same package. Children under three not eligible for the dining plans, but they can eat off the parents' plate or at a buffet free of charge. Trust me, that's the only free food you'll get out of Disney. we all know that. And credits expire at midnight on your package checkout date. That's the idea there you were talking about of, you know, if you're leaving and you've got some credits left, get over there to wherever and use them. Now, can you use those? You can't buy, like, candies or anything like any of the shops, can you, just downtown Disney?
Some of them you can. Some of the different locations, say you're going to Mouse Gear. If you go over to the little snack section where you'll see different, you know, maybe Chippendales bags of pretzels and things like that, they will, even in the stores, put that little emblem that Al John just showed, the Disney Dining Plant snack credit emblem.
Show that again, man.
There's a logo you need to look for right there for the Disney Dining Plan. All the snacks, all of that goody stuff on the menu. Most of the menus will have this to denote it, especially when you're at the parks, like at Pecos Bills or at the Electric Umbrella. You'll see this. That means it's going to work. Now, on the more of the elaborate table set for service restaurants, you know, or signature dining like Citrico's and Arcosi's and things like that, you won't see it, but the servers will come up to you and say, first, before we move any further, are you on the Disney Dining Plan? And they will explain it to you if you're unsure about what comes in the Disney Dining Plan. That way it's easy for you to make your decision, and they will help you point out certain things in the menu that you can order.
You know, once you get on the plan, do they put it on your little room card? Is that how it works? That it's your credits on your card, or how, for people wandering around? Okay, so you don't have to worry about keeping up with anything.
Yeah, because in order to purchase this plan, you have to be staying at a Disney resort. When it's free, of course, it's going to work differently because it's free. But if you're paying for this out of pocket, as an annual pass holder, because you don't need to buy tickets, you can actually add that dining plan on to your room. Okay. And everything is kept together. The only time you can't add that on without tickets is when it's free, because you're not paying for it.
I don't know how much we got into the food and wine thing, and if we covered that the way we wanted to, but I want to remind, we're having people kind of come in and out as I was watching the numbers. You're watching the first episode of what we call the WDW Travel Show, and this is going to be a weekly show done on Google Hangouts. You can join us at the WDWTravelShow.com website. There's a little chat area in there. You can ask questions. You can send information. There's information about us, about Al John, about Kristen, about myself, about what we do. Also, the other things we're involved in, our other blogs, our other items, and that types of thing. So we want you to encourage you to go there. And then our next show will be actually next Tuesday. We've got August 7th here, but it'll be August 6th. So it's August 7th, and we're going to talk about the Art Animation Resort. In a minute, Kristen, maybe we'll just give them a little heads up on what we're going to talk about there. August 13th, food and wine. Everything goes on sale for that the 14th, correct?
Yes. If you're an annual pass holder, you can purchase those ahead of time, or Disney Vacation Club. They do go on sale for those people on August 10th.
August 20th is up in the air, and then August 27th, not so scary Halloween. You can check us out every Monday night at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock Magic Kingdom time. So you figure out for where you are what that is. But 9 o'clock Magic Kingdom time, we're doing this through Google Hangouts. And the great thing about Google Hangouts is you do them live. They are broadcast worldwide live over YouTube, and then they are archived. So all you have to do is go back to our website, and we'll get them there. Now, did you say everything you wanted to about, before we move into some food, that you wanted to about food and wine?
I think so. We didn't have any other questions, did we?
We did have one question in the chat room. It was in regards to the resort mug. Can you tell everybody about what you get when you check in terms of the resort mug, where you can use it, and who gets one with a plan?
Okay, the way the resort mug works is it is unlimited refills at your resort. So if you're staying at, say, Coronado Springs, and you've decided you're going to take the day and hang out over at the Polynesian and walk around the resort and check it out, you can't go over to Captain Cook's and refill it there. It's one of the restrictions.
If you get caught, you can't do it.
That is not allowed on paper.
but we all know this
This
is one of the things that drives me nuts about Disney people who, and I love them, but people have griped more about these mugs and losing privileges, and they've been doing this for 20 years with the same mug they were supposed to quit using in 1990. But you're going to see it no matter where you go, and they're going to be doing it.
You know, at one time they did sell those mugs as being lifetime mugs.
Pepper Market.
Pepper Market did, because we have one of the lifetime refillable mugs from the Pepper Market. But I've never taken it and refilled it again. I have a huge collection of mugs.
Why do it?
Every person in your party gets a mug. And like I said, you can use it at your resort. You can go back as many times as you want during the length of your stay and fill up as much as you want. And I find we've paid for it out of pocket when we haven't been on the dining plan because it adds up. You know, if you're going and you're getting something to drink and it's like $2.79, well, $13.99 for the mug. Depending on the length of your stay, it's real easy to exceed that amount. If you're going in the morning, you're getting a cup of coffee, and then, say, in the evening when you come back, you're grabbing, you know, a Coke or something like that to drink, and you're doing that twice a day, well, in just a few days, you've already paid for itself.
Enjoy it while you can, folks, because the technology is out there now that eventually you're going to lose those free drinks. I know from my cruise writings, Royal Caribbean's already experimenting with a chipped mug, and that's the rumor that's been going around, these chipped mugs, a microchipped mug that will have a date on it so that when you go up to the station, you know, it will tell whether you are eligible for free or package Cokes or not, or drinks, whatever, and eventually it's going to go away. So, you know, enjoy it while you can. Just so now pull up some of these pictures that we talked about earlier, and we can take a look at some of the food. Now, these are all pictures that you've taken over your travels, correct?
Yes, they are.
As far and there are many more like this at the Cooking with Mickey blog, right?
Yes. Yes, there are tons of these photos. I have thousands
That's
and
all
thousands
you have to say is yes.
Let me tell you something, Ed. We cannot have a meal at Disney, at a Disney park, without waiting for 2 minutes for Kristen to get out her digital camera and to take multiple shots, beauty shots of the pictures. And I'm sitting there with my hands folded waiting for her to take every shot. I'm just sitting there. I know my role.
Well, I think when we were down there back in, what is it, October, I think I had to wait to eat mine, if I'm not mistaken.
That's true.
She was taking a picture or something. So, but you can learn a lot more about what goes on with food. Now, Kristen is by far and away the food expert. She's the foodie. But what is this right here that we're looking at? This is not a show tonight. You could get on the dining plan.
Yeah.
So.
And, of course, being a buffet, you can fill that plate up as much as you want with, you know, if you decided you want an entire plate just filled with mashed potatoes, you can do that.
All right.
Or you can have five plates. And that is from Boulangerie Patisserie. That is my best attempt at French. And that is the ham and cheese on baguette.
I said it looked like pizza. You said it was nothing like that at all.
It's very similar to a pizza. It's like pizza topping on a baguette. So you've got French bread instead of Italian. So.
Now this is why she was getting hungry earlier. We were looking at all these pictures and discussing them about, this might not be the one that gets you hungry here, but what is this?
It's a lettuce sandwich.
That's what it looks like. The one that you can see there at the front is actually their burger. Behind it, where you see the lettuce and the tomato, is what is called their Southwest black bean flatbread. And I really don't recommend it.
Okay. By the way, earlier we were talking about the turkey legs. Sometimes Google, and we did this the other day, and I can't remember the number, but the number of turkey legs they sell at Disney World every year is just phenomenal. You know, when you walk down, you know, like Frontierland, and everybody's got one. Now, what do we have here? This looks a little better.
Oh, okay. This is from the Flying Fish, which is one of my favorite signature dining restaurants that you can choose from.
It's over the boardwalk, right?
Yeah, over the boardwalk. You can see it. You can take the boat from Epcot right over there or from Disney's Hollywood Studios to grab your dinner. But that is one of their signature dishes called potato-wrapped red snapper, and it's served over leek fondue and has a veal glacé with red wine butter reduction. And it is delicious. Oh my gosh.
You know, I feel so bad for going to McDonald's for lunch today, you know, hearing you say this. All right, that's the flying fish. Okay.
Okay, that is a trio of pear desserts. As you can see, one of them is a poached pear. The one is like a pear cobbler topped with vanilla bean ice cream. And the other one is going to be, I'm trying to think of how to explain that.
Pears with ice cream, maybe?
It's
like an a la mode, honey.
No. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the dessert behind the poached pear.
A pear taco. I don't know.
Yeah, that's what I'm like, pear egg roll. That's what's coming to my mind. That I can't.
It's a wrapped pear. Okay, whatever it is, folks, is good. Now, where did this come from?
That is also from the flying fish.
Okay. One of your favorites.
Oh, yes, it is.
All right, what do we got?
Okay, now this is where, as you can see, looking at the back of the picture, that is from Epcot's Food and Wine Festival. That there is from 2 years ago, the United States marketplace that was set up. Heirloom tomatoes with Oregon blue cheese, red onion, and basil.
Yeah, that was good.
I love having this foodie here. This is so much fun. Now, this is one of the ones you were talking about earlier that you can take your food credits and maximize them. And this picture and the next picture are exactly what explains that.
Yeah, this is one that is $1.50. And, oh, my gosh, this is so good. I could eat 10 of these. I think I had 5 of them while we were there.
You had a lot, but, yeah.
What exactly is it?
That is pumpkin mousse with Ocean Spray cran raisins and orange sauce, and it is to die for.
But it's $1.50.
It's $1.50, so pay out of pocket for it.
For that snack credit that you would use, you could get this, which is what?
That is also from Hops and Barley Marketplace from last year. It's Linda Bean's Perfect Maine Lobster Roll, and that was somewhere around $8.
Nom, 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 nom.
Can you just do the oh my goodness one more time for us there, Alton?
Oh my goodness. That is heaven on a plate. I'm telling you right now, the Maine Lobster is so good. I mean, yeah.
Well,
everyone in the chat room's salivating at all these pictures.
Everyone on this panel is sitting salivating, too. I know I am because they're right in front of me, and I'm looking at them. Now, we've probably got some people that are going to be going. We may have some people who want a book. What is the availability? I know on the dining plan, the free dining for the fall, does it go until they sell out or till that they reach that date, or are there limited number of rooms that qualify?
Yeah, every discount Disney does is limited. So a room might be available, but it might not be available with the discount. So that's one thing to remember is if this is something you really want to take advantage of, you want to do it as soon as you can.
Okay. And we're going to spend, 2 weeks, we're going to talk extensively about food and wine for people who have never been. And as many times as I have been to Disney World over the years, and, I've been more than I can count here, 75 or 80, I had never been to food and wine until last year. And,
really?
I had never been. Now, I was at the opening day of Epcot, but I wasn't at food and wine. So, There's so much there, and it is such a neat thing. And I love time of year because you can get Mickey and food and wine together at the same time.
Yeah.
So it's a great time to be planning on going if you're thinking about going. And we're not trying to sell you anything, folks. We're trying to give you information about, what's available and what's good. So
I just want to move down to Orlando for the entire month of October just to do food and wine.
Gosh, that'd be nice.
and people may not know, and we'll go ahead and talk about this just for a minute, that as you're going around World Showcase back there and all of the different things are set up, they're not really priced all that, hard. I mean, not that high. I mean, you can get things for a couple of bucks up to maybe $6 or $7, $8, correct?
Yeah.
So you don't have to be worried about spending an awful lot of, you know, extra money because you're doing food and wine.
Yeah.
Especially if you use credits too.
Yeah, with free dining, those snack credits will move rather quickly if you're not careful. And, you know, something that Kristen and I do all the time, and you mentioned this earlier, Ed, is yes, when you use your room key to pay for your snacks and your meals, you do get a receipt. When you look at the receipt, make sure you keep them because there have been times where there have been some mistakes that we can catch when at the end of the night, Kristen reconciles the receipts just to make sure that we are on target and we know how much we need to spend, you know, for the remainder of the trip. And sometimes mistakes happen. If you're not careful, you could get overcharged on a particular snack, and then it's gone. What you can do, though, is that happened to us once. You go to the concierge, and you can dispute it and get that taken care of. So
sounds like a plan.
Yeah,
Let's review.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Oh no, it's always best to check your receipts, you know, as soon as you're done with the meal. And also, Kristen, you might want to mention how tipping works on the Disney Dining Plan before Ed wraps things up or does what he needs to do, because people are mystified by the tipping at times.
Well, Disney's known for putting a recommended tip amount listed on your check. But of course, they recommend 18%. I often tip 20%. When it's free, you're not paying for it. You know, I mean, and if your server does a good job, there's no reason not to take, you know, not to ever take care of your server. You work hard for their money, and you know, it's not always the easiest job. You often get blamed for mistakes that the kitchen makes. But, yeah, you'll want to tip. Disney recommends 18 to 20%. Of course, that's up to you. It's however you feel your server, what you feel they deserve.
Well, and, you know, everybody thinks that Disney is the epitome of service, and for the most part they are. But, you know, three of us have had the experience last year of a meal that lasted 3 hours that should have lasted 90 minutes.
Yeah.
So it's not always, you know, the way that you think it's going to go.
Well, and the one thing is, in that situation, because there were six or more of us at that table, it's automatically added.
Right.
And in that situation, if you are presented a bill and you really, for good reason, think that you should not pay that, something has happened, you know, you're really unhappy with the service you received, ask to speak to a manager, because that's the only way you can not have to pay that. If you just choose not to do that, technically they can come after you because you didn't. It's like walking out on your check. You know, you didn't pay the full amount. So that's one thing to remember in a situation like that. Another change that is happening, it currently is not in effect, but it will be taking effect next year, is I'm going to use the basic dining plan for an example. So say you've got your entree, your dessert, it's free. You decide, though, you want to add on an appetizer, and you want to get a bottle of wine. Well, because it's not included, now there may be an automatic gratuity placed on that of 18%. As of right now, that's what... It's kind of worded strangely on the brochure, so it's not clear as to if this will occur every time or if this is up to the restaurant's discretion of whether or not they want to add that or not.
I'm totally with you. If you're doing free dining, then gratuity should not even be a second thought. I mean, that should be something, you know. Now, you know, like everything else, if you're paying for dining plan, I mean, you've got to look out for yourself. But, I mean, 99.9% of the time, Disney service is the best, you know, for something of that magnitude. You know, when you're dealing with as many people as they are day in, day out, you know, they do a magnificent job. Let's go back and review the dining plan and what's going on with free dining for this fall. We kind of went over the plans and all, but Kristen, what are the dates now for what's available for people who want to go? And then, again, if you put any major changes for next year that's coming up for people looking at long term.
Okay. As far as the dates for the free dining plan, it is available to be booked now through September 29th. The arrival dates will be September 30th through October 4th, October 19th through November 1st, November 9th through the 15th, November 23rd through the 29th, and December 10th through the 13th.
Does that include Thanksgiving? I think it is in that. It sounds like it.
That does include Thanksgiving.
You know, that would be a great time to go. I mean, someone thinking about. Yeah. I know because my birthday is right in there. Somebody wants to chip in. You know, make a nice little
It starts the day after Thanksgiving Day.
That'll work.
Yeah.
That'll work. What day is that?
Well, there you go. They're going to be over at Liberty Tree Tavern having yourself some turkey, mac and cheese, and some apple pie.
One of my favorite places, Liberty Tree Tavern.
There you go.
Favorite meal ever at Disney World, Aljon?
Wow. I think, okay, I would say Victorian Albert's. That is not included in any dining plan. It is upper end. And something that Chris and I saved a bunch of our Mickey dollars from our Disney Visa in order to have. But that was the best meal ever. Now, in terms, and I could go into detail, but I'm sure we'll save that for another show. But in terms of what is included in the dining plan and in free dining in particular, Chris and I enjoyed this so much, we have to go again. Believe it or not, it is two credits for this particular experience, and that would be the Hoop-Dee-Doo review. I love that place.
I love Hoop-Dee-Doo.
Hoop-Dee-Doo Review is a dinner and a show. It requires two dining credits, and I absolutely love it. I can't tell you.
Fort Wilderness.
Yeah, it's a Fort Wilderness. Absolutely love it. And this is relatively new because Kristen and I's favorite place is like Flying Fish or Narcosis. Those two places are amazing. The Surf and Turf at those places are great. You know, and I would say, you know, Narcosis is probably a very, very close second by like 0.2% to me. But definitely, I would say that Hoop-Dee-Doo Review is a lot of fun. So.
And have you ever been a part of the show at the Hoop-Dee-Doo Review? Because they get people out of the audience.
I haven't been pulled up on the show. However, we did get serenaded. They did come by, and it's like, especially in the beginning, you know, oh, you guys are celebrating your anniversary, you're from Nashville, or whatever the case is, and everybody has a hoot and holler, a good time, and that's what I love about the spirit of the show, and the food was great, we had a great server, and my favorite course is dessert, which is something that I'm forbidden now because of my diet, and it is the best, and my eyes roll in the back of my head, the strawberry shortcake and the skillet.
Absolutely.
And what is it? Mom's recipe. I absolutely love that. It's mouth-watering good, and I swear, if left to my own devices, I would eat the whole thing by myself. It's that good.
I did get called up onto the show one time.
Oh.
And, you know, they have like four people they bring up, and one guy plays an Indian, and I was going to be the Indian, and then they had a little kid that was going to be there. Well, the little kid backed out, so I had to do both parts.
Oh, that's so great.
Oh, it was good. So the little kid has to get on the floor and kick and scream. Of course, I was great at that. Kristen, you can't say what Aljon said. What's your favorite meal?
Okay, since I can't say Victorian Albert's. Wow. Oh, this is so hard.
I tell you what, I'm going to tell you mine real quick.
Yes, please, Ed. Please.
This is not a fancy meal by any chance, but I had a convention down there, and we had about 25 of us, and we all had dinner in the private dining room at California Grill, and these were all people I've worked with for years. We could all go out and watch the fireworks at the same time. A lot of people, and I will tell you this, and we'll do some shows in the future about conventions and meetings, and there's no fine place in the world to have a meeting than Disney. Disney World, Disneyland, Disney Cruise Line, all of them. But there were a lot of people there in this group that thought when I said we're going to have our meeting at Disney World that I lost my mind because they weren't Disney people. But once we did, they were convinced. And I remember doing that, and it's the great time that everybody had. Now, that's not from a food standpoint the best, but that was one of my best memories. All right, Kristen, you've had time to think.
Okay, I'm going to go with GECO. I was really, really surprised by GECO. It was the last, almost the last. I still have one more signature dining restaurant to try, but the last one that I did was GECO. And I was so surprised at how good the food was. You know, typically you sit down, you have a meal, and you sample somebody else's dish, and you're like, oh, man, mine's better, or I should have gotten yours, you know, that kind of thing. Neither of them were better. They were both fantastic. I mean, every single thing we had was so good. And because wine in South African wine is so big there, and they have such a huge selection of it. I mean, it's listed as one of the best places to get wine, South African wine, in the United States, is GECO. And so their servers know an awful lot about the wine. You can tell them what kind of wines you like to drink if you're looking for something different, and they can recommend something. So, and that's exactly what we did, is, you know, asked him for his advice and went with one of those.
There may be people watching who don't know where GECO is.
It is located over at the Animal Kingdom Lodge.
And, you know, I've had people ask me, you know, at holidays, what's a good place to go? And I was there for Christmas one year. We had dinner at Boma, you know, the buffet, I guess you call it, which has a tremendous amount of African food or food native to Africa, and that was quite an experience too. But I haven't tried GECO yet. We'll have to try that somewhere down the road.
That's a beautiful, speaking of Christmas, that's a beautiful place to be for the holidays. It just has that really cozy, you know, the restaurants and the resort itself are all very cozy feeling.
Favorite hotel just to hang out in for a short time, Aljon.
I'll go with the, I had it and it took my tongue. We just stayed there. It's Coronado Springs. I love Coronado Springs. I was going to say Polynesian, but I changed my mind. Coronado Springs has got a lot of great stuff that I enjoy. And actually, Kristen turned me on to it. We've stayed there a few times. And, you know, I really enjoy how quiet the resort is. I feel that when I stay there, I'm relaxed. I don't have a bunch of noisy people running around. There's great opportunities to walk around, and that's something I didn't really mind doing when I was there because it's so picturesque. And Kristen would take me out to the little sandy beach area, whatever, and the hammock area. So relaxing. Great atmosphere there. Great rooms. Great Pepper Market food court. The club there, the little coffee shop there is great. There's just so many great things I love about that place. So I really feel that I'm out of, you know, your typical, you know, I feel like I'm on vacation. And that's the most important thing to me is when I'm there. And then, of course, Polly, I get that too, but not in the same way, you know.
Well, mine's always going to be Polynesian. There's no question about that. Just go upstairs, sit, watch people come through, walk out at night with the tiki torches and the music playing, and look across the lagoon and see, you know, Magic Kingdom and the castle. There's no question. Kristen, what about you?
Well, my favorite resort is Coronado, and of course he takes that. So I'm going with the Animal Kingdom Lodge. Again, I like the food. It's comfy. It's cozy. Where else can you go in, say, in winter when it's cool enough outside to sit around, you know, or you need a sweater and jeans, to sit around a fire pit and see the animals outside at night roaming? You know, I mean, there's no other place that you can do that, so... Yeah, it's just, it's a very, very cozy, comfy resort. And again, it takes you completely away from Disney because you can't see anywhere a symbol from a park.
Nowhere.
Yeah, it is. You can't see the Magic Kingdom. You can't see Epcot. You can't see Hollywood Studios. All you can see is animals. So.
Well, we're going to talk about these and the other things, and sometime we'll talk about our favorite breakfast, which is I have one of those. We'll get that on another show. It involves going to ketchup jail, I will tell you that.
Oh, no.
Have you been there?
You've done that. Oh, geez.
I've been to ketchup jail. Had to ride the hobby horse in the whole nine yards.
Oh, my.
We have our schedule set up next week. Next Tuesday, we're going to talk about Art of Animation. Kristen, you've been over there. You spent some time over there on your last trip. Give us a little preview of what you're going to tell us next week.
Well, we walked around the resort and checked out the areas that are already open and kind of peeked through the fencing to get a look at what the Little Mermaid's going to look like. And we dined over at Landscape of Flavors. So we spent probably about 2 to 3 hours over there just walking around and eating and taking it all in. So even though we didn't stay there, there's a good bit to talk about of what can be expected.
We'll be feeding you, or we hope you'll be feeding us some questions about that. We'll be giving you information about what's going on there. That'll be next Tuesday at 8 o'clock. Now, put this on your calendar, 9 o'clock Disney time. Put this on your calendar. Starting the 13th, these episodes will be every Monday, unless we don't have one. But every Monday, 9 o'clock, Magic Kingdom time, and we have the agenda set up through the end of the month, a little bit into October, but we'd love to hear from you if you have ideas for things you'd like us to talk about. More and more people will be coming in. We're kind of the core group, but we'll hope to have 5 or 6 people in here at any one time talking about things, and one of the things we're working on, we have the chat room before long, and I'm going to say in the next couple of months, we'll be able to actually take phone calls and talk to you about this as well. The website, wdwtravelshow.com. And again, let us know things you'd like to do. Some things I want to talk about down the road that are kind of unique are doing shows or doing meetings at Disney, which I've done a number of those and absolutely love doing conventions at Disney. We'll spend a lot of time on the cruise line as things moves along. And we'll talk about Disneyland and maybe some of the overseas parks as well. So you guys got any ideas of things you want to do, Aljon?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I'd love to actually do a cruise at a Disney Cruise Line. That'd be awesome. You know, I've done some cruises before, a lot of them, but not the Disney Cruise Line. So I'm waiting around that. And, of course, I had been to Tokyo Disneyland. I didn't go to Disney Sea, but I'm looking forward to talking about the rest of the Disney parks overseas. And I think that's on my bucket list. I think I've shared that with Kristen before, and maybe you, Ed. And that's on the bucket list. Before I kick the bucket, I want to go to every Disney park that I possibly can. So hopefully we'll make that a reality at some point.
The good news is they're going to keep building them so you can never die.
Yes. Yeah. I'll be like Walt, and I'll be submerged underneath the park in a frozen ice, you know.
Now, Kristen just involved, of course, we're going to be doing a lot with food. Kristen, you got any ideas, shows? I know you came up with an idea when we were first talking that I absolutely loved, and that's we're going to do a show down the road on the free things you can do when you're at Disney. You know, because there are so many things you can do. If you've never been and just, you know, I'm not talking about in the parks, but rode the monorail and look around and walk the resorts. Now, we're going to do a show on that. What about other things? Anything in mind that you got?
Oh, gosh. Right now, I can't think of anything. I mean, one thing I'm looking forward is to people giving us ideas of things that they want now. Because as often as we have all been, you kind of forget. It's harder to look at things from the perspective of somebody who has never been or goes maybe once every 3 years. You know, things that people want to know why they're planning, like what do you look for as far as information? So I'm looking forward to people telling us what it is they want us to talk about.
There are people out there who have never been to Disney World and who I get this question every now and then, what do I do first? You know, and different people have to me, it's always Magic Kingdom. been, but that's me.
Yeah, I think a lot of people want to know what priority they need to hit certain things, you know, and it's definitely something worth exploring. You know, someone had said something about concierge and concierge level. People are talking about Disney Vacation Club, which is also a great topic, you know, and I like, you know, what things you can do as a single or as a married couple without the kids. That's something we can definitely explore. Kristen and I don't have children, but we do spend a lot of time in the parks, and there used to be a time in recent history that we used to one-up each other every time we go on our anniversary vacation. And sometimes I'd surprise her with, champagne and cheese and, you know, stuff in the room, and Kristen would take me out and have, you know, these really cool things happen at a certain park at a certain time. And there are just all these neat little things that you can do if you know the right people and the cast members, you know. So definitely a lot of stuff to talk about.
You know, you brought up a good topic. You're talking about, you were talking about being single, but what about a solo traveler who wants to go to Disney World? I have a good friend who writes a blog, two blogs actually, on traveling solo, one for Vegas and one for other traveling, and that's all she does. She goes everywhere solo. That might be a really good show down the road to get her involved and talk about it. And that's the kind of thing we'd like to hear from folks out there on. So,
going solo?
Yeah, going by
going
yourself.
Going solo is such a different experience, because when Aljon was working down in Florida, I would go with him, well, which meant during the week, I'm completely at the parks by myself because he's off at work. So I got the whole experience of traveling to Disney and doing everything in the parks and out, you know, all of that kind of stuff by myself. So it's really interesting the differences in traveling as a couple or traveling with kids or traveling with friends or extended family or by yourself. It's just such a different experience. I think that's definitely a good topic. Somebody mentioned... Oh, what was it that they wanted to know about? I saw something a minute ago, and I was like, I want to remember that.
Was it in the chat room?
Yeah. I think somebody mentioned something about, like, doing land and sea.
Yes.
I think that's what it was.
Yeah. Yes, I see it.
Okay.
Yeah. Doing land and sea combination. Yeah.
We're for it.
We're all for it. Land and Sea 2013.
Well, we're going to work on that. And that's a good, you know, I don't know if you do a whole show on that. I mean, I just think it's a good thing to do if you can do it. I mean, do a 4-night Disney cruise and then 3 or 4 nights at Disney. Whether you do one, whichever you do first, really is immaterial, I think.
It depends on which part of your vacation is typically relaxing. If you're at the parks and you go the entire time, doing the cruise on the back end might be a good idea, because that way you have more time to kind of relax and take things at a slower pace.
Yeah, but you know, and I don't disagree with that, but then I look at it and I think, but then I'd like to have the cruise to be looking forward to going to the parks, you know. And so, you know, there's no winning answer there. So, anyway, folks, we hope we'll hear from you. You can email us. You can drop us a note. Put something in the chat room. Leave some notes. Now, tomorrow, this cast will actually be on the website, #1, and we'll be developing the page and the pictures you saw tonight. All of that will be on there, plus some other information, and you'll be able to drop notes in there too. So, you know, that's what this is all about, is we build this library of shows about, you know, basically this, I call it science of traveling Disney. And if you're a Disney aficionado, as they say, maybe you'd like to be on here with us sometime. We'd love to have some guests pop in and spend some time. All you need, it's a great thing about Google Hangouts, all you need is a computer and a webcam and a microphone, and you're in business. So I guess it's going to wind up for the night, guys.
Sounds great. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for having us. Yes.
Kristen, we'll see you Tuesday. The reason we can't do this Monday is Tristan's fault, okay? I just want to let you know that. So it'll be Tuesday, 9 o'clock. Is it not your fault?
Yeah. She's got a date with Sugar Ray's fault.
I know. She's got to go to a concert that you forgot about. It'll be Tuesday night, 9 o'clock, Magic Kingdom time. 9 o'clock, MGT. No, MKT, Magic Kingdom time.
I love that.
Tuesday. I can't get that in my head. We're going to talk about Art of Animation 2 weeks from Monday, or a week from this next Monday. Food and Wine is going to be a very special show because everything goes on sale the next day. So I hope you have a great rest of the week. We will see you Tuesday night, and tell your friends. Now we start publicizing. We're going to get this first show under our belt and try to get things worked out, like me here in Dublin in the beginning, which now I know what to do about that. And next time it'll be a little smoother than that. It didn't go bad, but it'll be a little smoother. Have a great week, everybody. Guys, I'll see you later, and we're out.